Hi, Misha here, and quite recently did a couple of videos, one looking at the Lockheed EC-121 Warning Star, initially known as the WV-1, WV-2, and so on, in the Navy, and also the E-3 Sentry. These are early warning aircraft, or in the case of the E-3, true AWACS, which were command communications aircraft. And both of those models are 1/144 scale from Corgi. So that's why I didn't include these in that video, because these are 1/72 scale, and they're from Hobbymaster. And they are, of course, of the quite legendary Grumman E-2, they're both actually E-2Cs, although this is an early one, this is a late one, Hawkeyes. And these are classified as airborne early warning and command aircraft, used by the United States Navy. And really this was the first purpose-built early warning aircraft, and it has the distinction of being the longest production run of any carrier-based aircraft. And that's kind of the distinction here. The WV-2, the Warning Star, while it was Navy, was land-based. And that was adopted and would go into service in 1954. But in 1956, the Navy knew it had a need for... Sorry about that. Well, I'm not apologizing to you, I just slammed my knee into the floor and it hurt, but hey, there you go. Had a need for a carrier-based early warning aircraft with some command and control abilities. Now, going back to World War II and right after, they would use the TBM-3W, the Avenger, and they would use the Douglas 81 as radar-equipped aircraft, but these were, you know, small, not really capable. The first one the Navy really modified for this would be the WF, also known as the Willie Fudd 1, later known as the E-1 Tracer, and this was a modification of the S-2, so it was not a clean sheet design. It had a radar kind of clapped on it. It was a piston engine propeller aircraft. So in 1956, the Navy said, hey, we need a carrier-based early warning radar-equipped aircraft. And Grumman was kind of the natural choice, and therefore Grumman's design proposal was officially selected in March of 1957. So as always, a lot of compromises had to be made to make such a large purpose-built aircraft fit on board a carrier. Folding wings, of course, a tail hook. This used new turboprop engines as opposed to the old pistons. Had a crew of 5. We'll talk about more of that later. And of course, the centerpiece of the whole thing was its rotodome, or ratodome as my speech says. A very advanced radar with some very advanced computer and electronic systems for the 1950s. And this was adopted initially as the W2F-1 in the Navy, but it was often called the Super Fudd, because again, the original was called the Willie Fudd. So design work and prototyping began. The first aerodynamic prototype would fly on October 21st, 1960, and the first fully radar-equipped and ready-to-go prototype would go up in April of 1961. And so then they began to get these ready to go. Now, of course, in 1962, the naming convention would change. The original WF-1 would become the E-1. And the new W2F1, which really wasn't in full service yet, would become the E2 Hawkeye. And it would officially enter into U.S. Navy service in January of 1964, and quite frankly was a disaster. It had problems with overheating of the components. It still had a lot of old analog components, including a very primitive computer by our modern standards. And had a lot of problems with overheating, especially in the rotodome and in the fuselage where all this electronics was packed. It produced a lot of excess heat and just didn't have a way to get over, kind of get rid of it. They had actually built 59 aircraft when in 1965 it was canceled. It was immediately halted from production. And even though it had just gone on its first cruise that year, it was pretty much almost considered dead in the water. Congress was pissed, and the Navy and Grumman both had to kind of scramble to fix things. Now, as I said, this is an E-2C. The E-2A was the initial production version that didn't really work. The E-2B was quickly put into service. And this essentially went to a more modern digital computer. And they did everything they could to work with the heat. It was basically an electronics and computer systems update to deal with the heat problem and other issues. And this really did help. There would be new production E-2Bs, and they would also take 49 of the 59 E-2As and upgrade them to the new standard. Therefore, the Hawkeye was saved and was kind of reintroduced to the fleet in the mid-60s, the mid-Vietnam period. But this was always felt to be an interim, a stopgap solution. In 1968, they would begin a program for product improvement, which would ultimately result in the E-2C. The first ones were actually taken from the remaining E-2As and updated for E-2C prototypes. First would fly in 1971, and it would be approved for mass production in 1972, and first enter into fleet service in 1973. And yet again, we have mostly electronic and radar upgrades, as well as some instrumentation and engine upgrades. And this would end up being kind of the definitive version for several years. Now, this model is actually from the Israeli Air Force, and Israel would be the first export user of the Hawkeye. Kind of interesting. And they would fly theirs from land, but yet they still had elements like the tail hook and the folding wings. So yeah, let's talk a little bit more about this aircraft. At nearly 58 feet long, and with a wingspan verging on 81 feet, the Hawkeye is not a small aircraft by anyone's measure. However, for a carrier-based aircraft, it's quite enormous. But it was a necessary part of modern warfare, and has been an integral and very important part of the fleet since the 60s, since really the bees kind of started to work out the bugs. Of course, it's responsible for early warning. It's responsible for coordinating the CAP, the Combat Air Patrol, so defense of the fleet. It's also responsible for helping coordinate and track and guide offensive or strike forces from the Navy, from the fleet. It's also important for air traffic control near the fleet, supplies, logistics, what have you, communications, passing things along, signal, you know, that kind of stuff of that nature. It's also very important in search and rescue missions, anything to do like that. It's a very versatile craft. It has a crew of 5, so much smaller than the Warning Star or Sentry. Pilot and co-pilot, and they're located up front here in the cockpit. And then in the rear cabin, all the way kind of back here near the rotodome, we have the radar officer, we have kind of the air traffic control officer, we have the combat coordination officer. So you have 3 in the back and 2 up front. So a much smaller crew than the others, but again, carrier based. And it does take advantage of more automation than the Warning Star. It has 2 main engines. Initially they had 4 bladed, very large propellers. Its maximum speed is about 400 miles per hour. And it has a cruise speed of about 300 miles per hour. It has a ceiling of just below 35,000 feet. Like a lot of naval aircraft, it doesn't have a super high altitude. But what it does have is range and endurance. When launched from a carrier, it can cruise and be on station for up to 6 hours. And, like this Israeli version, when launched from land, it can be in the air for 8 hours. So, very good. That's kind of the trade-off instead of having jets. And, of course, it's hauling this giant radar sensor. And, of course, that uses a lot of power, too. So, it's an interesting aircraft to fly. And it really came into its own with the E-2C, but it was important even during the Vietnam War, becoming the eyes of the fleet. Its first cruise was on the USS Kitty Hawk, and it would continue to be used through the end of the war. Like I said, the Cs started to come into use in 73. The initial production ones were known as Group Zero. Beginning in the late 70s, they started manufacturing what would become known as Group 1. These would enter into service in 1981. And that would be followed by Group 2, which would enter into service shortly after the Gulf War, which would be 1992. And each time they did this, they would upgrade the engines, the radar, the electronics, just the overall capability and versatility of the aircraft. And a lot of times they would make new production craft, and sometimes they would upgrade existing craft. At this point, we've built well over 100, all told. And it's becoming quite the success. For example, the U.S. Navy used it in 1981, during the whole Gulf of Sidra affair, where Hawkeyes helped F-14s guide in on and ultimately shoot down 2 Libyan SU-22s. And again, they would be used during Operation El Dorado Canyon in 1986 to coordinate with F-14s. They actually worked quite closely with F-14s, which makes sense because it's another Grumman product. And they were a critical component along with the E-3 during the 1991 Gulf War. And aside from some kind of less than ideal handling characteristics because they're carrier based, by the time of the C, the aircraft was really quite evolved, frankly. But in 1994, Grumman would merge with Northrop, becoming Northrop Grumman. And this new entity, this new company, set its sights on keeping the Hawkeye with 2020 vision as it would move into the 21st century. So we really start to see a lot of upgraded update programs at this time. That's actually why this Israeli model looks somewhat different, especially in the propellers, from this model, which is a new one from Hobby Master. And this is from the Japanese Air Self-Defense Force, circa 2019. Oh yes, the Hawkeyes are still very much flying to this day. So, I'll just go over it a little bit. I'm not going to go too much into detail. But, yeah. One of the first programs that Northrop Grumman worked with was the Group 2 Plus, which was an update to the navigation system, as well as some of the displays for the pilot. Now, the U.S. Navy planned to have all frontline units equipped with the Group 2 by 1997, employing 75 Hawkeyes. So the older aircraft would be either retired, sold off, or put in the reserves. And at this time, most carriers would have 4 on board. That way, one could be on station 24/7 if necessary. But after this, Grumman really went to a larger program, which would ultimately become Hawkeye 2000. This was an update to even more systems, and of course, visually, the biggest thing would be these new propellers, known as the NP-2000. They have 8 blades made of carbon fiber. They reduced vibration. By the way, as the old name Superfud kind of fell out, the new name, nickname for these became the Hummer. But, yeah, the older propellers had more vibration than was ideal. Also, if you needed to replace or repair a blade, you had to remove the hull assembly. With the newer style, you could remove individual blades, so it made maintenance a lot more effective. We're also using GPS and other modern systems like that, and ultimately we would get modern displays. And the Hawkeye 2000 system, with the new propellers and everything, would kind of come in waves, starting in 2003, running through 2004. And these would, of course, be deployed for operations over Iraq in the Second War. In fact, all 10 active squadrons would provide overland surveillance and control during that war, and actually would do so for a long time. For example, in 2014, the Hawkeye was stationed to fly over Iraq and support operations against the Islamic State, ISIS, later ISIL. And they would also be used for more humanitarian purposes. For example, helping out after Hurricane Katrina, they would provide air traffic control and coordination for 3 states after that hurricane disaster. And these would also be used by U.S. Customs and the DEA for drug interdiction and enforcement during the 1980s and in the 90s. And the Coast Guard would even borrow some for a time. This is still pretty much a Navy aircraft. And work would not end with the E-2C Group 2 Plus and the Hawkeye 2000. It was considered to retire it, but instead, Northrop Grumman proposed the E-2D, also known as the Advanced Hawkeye, and the first prototype there flew in 2007, with the earliest deliveries to the Navy in 2010, and these would reach initial operational readiness towards the end of 2014, going on their first cruise in 2015. and the Navy would order 50 of the new aircraft. So apparently they, you know, kind of like the E-2D. One neat new feature. Starting in 2016, test flights would be made with the version that was capable of being refueled in the air. This would extend the potential duration over 15 hours. And it was successful, and therefore the Navy started taking delivery of its first aerial refuelable E-2Ds in 2019. Also, with the new E-2D, and since it had expanded capabilities, it was decided to station 5 on board each aircraft carrier rather than the original 4. Now, one thing to note, when this was adopted, it was expected to operate off the World War II era Essex class carriers. Now, keep in mind, they had been upgraded for jet operations, but still they were relatively small. But, of course, with newer carriers, the super carriers, there's more space on board. And this is only helped by the fact that the large F-14s are retired in favor of the smaller F-18 Hornets and the more recent F-35s. But I said this had the ability to be refueled in the air now. That actually wasn't something started by Northrop Grumman. Rather, the Israelis were the first to give the Hawkeye that ability. They have their own Israel aircraft industry, and it would modify their aircraft so they could top them off, because the Israelis put these in combat quite early on. And with that, let's close out by talking about the foreign users of the Hawkeye. The Israeli Air Force would be the first foreign user. Israel would be the first export customer. In 1981, they acquired 4 E-2Cs, and they wouldn't have to wait long. In 1982, they would be heavily used during the war with, Syrian forces, I should say. And quite effectively, they would keep usually 2 in the air at any time, and they were credited with helping destroy 90 enemy aircraft, SAM installations, and other targets. After this showing, they were kept on pretty constant early warning patrols throughout the 80s and up through about 1994. And then they started to kind of draw them down. Interestingly, 3 of the 4 were sold to Mexico, and their Navy would employ them. The 4th was actually just put on museum display. In the same region, in 1987, Egypt would pick up 5 E-2Cs, with an additional 6th in the 1990s. And then they would be interested in upgrading to new standards, the 2000 standard, I guess you would say, and eventually would pick up 2 more around the same time period in the early 21st century, so operating a total of 7. Now, the second largest user would actually be Japan. Because of their proximity to China and the USSR, airborne early warning was very important to them. So they purchased a total of 13 beginning in 1987. And these would be very important. They would continue to fly them. And Japan's actually going to pick up some of the new E-2Ds. Originally in 2014, they announced an interest. Originally, they were going to get 4. And then later, this has been up to at least 9. Currently, they operate 2 squadrons. And no signs of showing that to end. And as you see on this model, They have upgraded theirs to the Hawkeye 2000 standard as well, with the new propellers and new instrumentation. So they're keeping them going. Another very interesting user is France, specifically the French Navy. In 1987, they acquired 3 E-2Cs, and 2 of these would actually be stationed on the carrier Charles de Gaulle, making France the only other operator from an aircraft carrier, and the third one would operate from a shore base. They too were interested in upgrading their aircraft, and while they were at it, they also purchased a 4th one to kind of supplement their fleet. And in recent times, last year, they decided to acquire 3 new E-2Ds to replace their aging E-2Cs. Singapore would acquire 4 around the same time as kind of everyone else. 1987 seems to be a popular year, and they would fly these for air patrol and early warning until 2012, at which time they were retired and replaced with a variant of a Gulfstream. And then we have Taiwan. They would have an interesting variant, and they would be one of the last purchasers. In 1995, they would pick up, I believe it was 4, might have been 3 or 5, anyway, it's been a long day. And these were known as E-2Ts. And the difference seems to be that they were built using some components from retired U.S. Navy E-2Bs, but they still had the electronics of an E-2C. So they're kind of a hodgepodge, made specifically for Taiwan. I would imagine they probably got them at a very reasonable price. And then they too were interested in the Hawkeye 2000 program, and their upgraded E-2Ts were designated as E-2Ks. Plus, they would acquire 2 new production E-2Ks very soon after the Hawkeye program 2000 went underway. And the last of their older ones, yeah, they had 4, by the way, I just remembered. The last of their older 4 would be remanufactured and delivered back to them from the USA in 2013. So they are still flying 6 E-2K Hawkeyes that has some kind of interesting E-2B features. For example, I think the nose is a little different. And that's kind of where we're at. It's a interesting aircraft, obviously. It doesn't have any weapons. And while propellers might seem a little unusual, it's the fuel efficiency factor that really matters. And the radar here, that's why I'm very, very careful. These stands are a little wobbly. This is 24 feet, so nearly as large as that of the E-3, which is 30 feet. It does rotate on the Hobbymaster. But again, it's pretty stiff on all this, so yeah. I just don't want to knock this over these big old wings. It's a very heavy model, though. It does have gear up or down. And it does have a canopy you can open. You can't display it open. Well, I guess you could, but it'd look weird. But that's so you can have your crew in or out. It'd be kind of neat if you had the 3 backseaters, or back compartmenters, but you don't. The fuselage is solid. So it's just the 2 in the front. I guess, technically, there wouldn't be really a way to do it. Although, it would be kind of nice if there was a way to display the side door open or closed. I think that'd be a neat feature. But, oh well. Still a nice Hobbymaster model. They always do nice jobs. And again, it's pretty much all metal. part of the verticals are plastic with the horizontals metal. The wings are metal, as is the body. I just wish they came with a little better stand, frankly. So what do you think? Now that we've covered the Warning Star, the Sentry, and the Hawkeye, which is your favorite? This one rotates a little easier. Let me know in the comments. Hope you enjoyed it. It's a fun aircraft for me to talk about. As always, if you could, like, share, and subscribe, and all that good stuff. This is Misha, and I'll catch you very soon next time.